All right, so on this slide, so actually in the course of this talk, there will probably be another 50 million devices added to our connected world. And perhaps some of you are gonna go out and buy something else. Maybe there's some cool wearables, or you know, last time I came, they had a little button from ISC Square that blinked and kind of did sort of stuff. So there's probably some other way we can be more connected by the end of the night. Right, or I'm not sure when the after party is. Maybe they're gonna give RFID bracelets or something like that. So there's a lot of stuff in the world and it's gonna keep growing, right? So what do we do about it? Because it's a bit of a challenge. I mean, does anyone really think it's a challenge? Anyone having any challenges in your connected space? I mean, we're all impacted. We may not think that we're impacted. So I ask you just to stop for 10 or 20 seconds and think about your viewpoint today. I'm sure some of you have 3 or 4 or 5 or 6 Alexas in the home, every room, sensors on all the doors, cameras, iPhone, watch. You have a lot of connected stuff from a consumer person. I'm sure most of you work in a business that has connected stuff. We're all connected some way. I mean, some of you like me, maybe you used a parking app to park today at San Francisco. Anyone use a parking app to park? I discovered that last night. Sometimes human error fails our connected world. I was so excited that I got pre-parking. I have my little pass. I'm cruising up here. I got GPS on my car. I get to there, and guess what? There's a little thing outside that says the parking lot is temporarily full. I have no alternative plan. I drive by, and the bar had been broken. Maybe somebody drove through it, human error. And the parking guy in there was trying to fix it. He goes, I'm trying to fix it as fast as possible. Go around the street. So I go around the building, did not find the entrance. And I'm thinking, my connected world has failed me right now. I have only so much time to get to the conference and I have no parking space. But fortunately, by the time I got around the block, he had fixed the gate thing and I was able to park. So in the end, my IoT app worked. So think about your perspective, because we're all gonna have homework at the end of this presentation. Today, and in the last couple years, I mean, these industry verticals are just, they're going at lightning speed. And I think it's kind of cool. I mean, if you think about it, all the great stuff we have today, like connected parking, that's pretty cool. Connected transportation, there's all sorts of things out there. All around the world, connected cities. A couple years ago, when I was doing a research report for my master's, read a report about how Singapore had tens of thousands of sensors within the city, hundreds of thousands of sensors, and they had the ability to detect if a resident had thrown out a cigarette butt or chewing gum because it's illegal in the city of Singapore. I mean, think about that. You're in these sky rises and there's so many sensors around, they can detect a little piece of bubble gum or whatever going down in the street. Or connected healthcare. How many people, anyone here actually experienced connected healthcare recently? Okay, once you have, you won't want to go back. I mean, last week, unfortunately, my husband was in the hospital. He actually had a medical crisis. We're in a different state. A new hospital, not a new hospital I've ever been to. No connected medical solutions. There's actually no monitoring the room. Old school room. And I'm like, oh my God, the nurses have no way of knowing if the oxygen level is high enough. So I spent the night. His connected medical was me sitting in the bed next to him, listening to him breathe. I've been in a high-tech hospital that had all the connected stuff. So once you go connected, you don't really want to go back. I think all of us have experienced the great things that IoT allows us to do in this world. But some of us have probably experienced the downside. Did you get a malware infection? Did you have a DDoS attack? Did something happen that you didn't expect? I think so. I didn't have the opportunity to check the news today or this week because I've been a little bit preoccupied. But I'm sure there's been something in the IoT realm that happened in the last week. I know already in 2019, we've had some interesting things that had happened. So a short timeline. I'm sure most of you remember the wake-up call that was Mirai. Kind of interesting, although it wasn't the first one, it was like the big wake-up call. If you think back 30 years ago, for those of you who are in the 50s plus area, when we had Morse worm, it wasn't the first big worm, but it was definitely the first wake-up call. And everybody said, OMG, we need to do something. So since then, there's been quite a few different types of attacks. This talk isn't about attacks, but just to give you a timeline. And many of these were variations on a theme. Just like many threat actors, you don't have to necessarily invent anything, actually, to see what the guy next to you did was pretty cool. Tweak a few things, boom, voila, you have some great stuff. Most of these were default credentials. right, or old Unix, Linux variants that did various things. Some of them were pretty good. For example, like the Reaper, which was a takeoff and more advanced than Mirai, it had like pretty, what's the number here, so I look at it, something like 90,000, no, that was the hide and seek, botnet of 90,000 devices. So if you think of all these at scale, and the hide and seek one was in 2018, and actually the hide and seek was the first IoT malware that was able to survive a system restart. Actually, most IoT devices, you can't necessarily reboot. If they're considering routers and some of these other things, you can. And what about today? It's 2019. So what are some of the things that, the predictions that have taken place? I'm not sure that we've seen any of these yet, but one paper that I referenced talked about adversarial AI. I'm sure there's probably a talk happening at RSA this week, which is talking about adversarial AI. It's about making tweaks. For example, you know, something, you know, take a Tesla that's supposed to recognize a stop sign, you change a few bits, and then it doesn't really see it. Or Alexa, change a few bits in the voice recording, and there's commands that are being given to Alexa that it interprets a different way. Once someone is successful with a true adversarial AI attack, we're going to see many other threat actors go, okay, that's cool, I don't necessarily have to invent it, but I can improve it. And then we're going to see how many devices we could do. Fake apps, I think we've already seen fake apps in the industry today. We're bound to see more fake apps. And then modular IoT defenses. As you get more, build your IoT thing. You can get a kit. You can get all kinds of things. You can get your app. You can get your development toolkit. And for example, maybe you have 10 toolkits that use one component from something else. And that one component happened to have a software bug. A little bit challenging. Even Hello World can have software issues in it, have proper coding and things. All right. So the attacks are going to keep coming, and they're only going to get bigger. And there's a lot of stuff out there, net. So what were some of the repeat patterns in these? Right. The biggest one we keep hearing about is known default credentials. I mean, I'm not even going to be moving this. We need to get rid of using passwords. I think everybody can agree on that. And they usually result in denial of service. All of these I think you're familiar with, web issues, web security issues, pivot attacks, right? Maybe you don't think you're going to be a victim of a pivot attack, but neither did the casino in Las Vegas think that they would get their database hacked through the thermometer in the fish tank. And they're looking for these opportunities of pivot attacks when, for example, I just bought a new smart washer and dryer combo. Of course, I haven't hooked it up to my mobile app yet because I haven't done the proper amount of research, but it's cool, right? But okay, so what are they doing? I did experience a repeater attack, I don't know if that's the right word, where they tried to steal one of our cars. They probably had a small antenna. We weren't home, we were in El Paso, and it happened to so be that my backup VOB for my RL was in the console of my RDX. And so they did need a very big repeater, right? If they're walking around the neighborhood at 4 o'clock in the morning with this really big repeater, it's kind of obvious that they have a little one. Never thought I would have that. So now the keys are in a metal box and will be protected. So we're gonna see these, we've seen these common patterns in the industry repeatedly. I'm sure we'll see one in the next week, maybe even while we're here at RSA. It's quite common for those who are on call, anyone in here, right? Something big happens when you're away at a conference. There's a denial of service attack, there's a data breach, there's something because they're like, hey, all the IT folks are gonna be at the conference, let's see what we can do back home. Or maybe what are people doing in your connected homes because, hey, it's a conference and people are gonna be away. They might be in San Francisco doing this sort of attack. So why are the threat actors keep gaining grounds on us? One, in the course of this hour, there's gonna be 50 million more devices. Over the course of 2019, they're predicted another 1.6 billion devices. That could be more, it could be less. So the threat landscape keeps increasing faster than we can actually secure it, especially since we don't have the proper design and IoT endpoints, or we don't have the proper management capabilities to manage hundreds of thousands of endpoints at scale. Although there are vendor solutions that exist, and I encourage you all to check out the vendor expo, I guess it's down here. There'll be multiple big companies down there, on there. And the variations on the theme, right? They're all common patterns, right? People are actually building components. For example, take the web camera that was hacked through the IoT hack. It was actually a generic camera made in an Asian country that many OEM vendors were using to make their own camera. And then they were customizing the special code base. Well, the base code had issues, and that was just replicated for every vendor that said, hey, I'm going to white label that. We're going to make something different. So you have these variations on a theme. And common, vendors are still using old OS versions. So I challenge you all, the next time you, or something you have in your home today, because you can do this at home, I did with Wemo devices as a part of my master's research. If you have an Alexa or whatever you have, even try to do, it's kind of harder on your Apple Watch, go home, do some network capture, watch the traffic, try to log in and see what version of Micro Linux it's running. Most cases will be 2, 3, 4, 5 years old, unpatched. Right? That's just the way it is. But why are they doing that? Because we're all keep buying. Right? How many people are going to say, I'm never buying another connected device in my life? As a matter of fact, I'm going to go home and throw out all those Alexas. No, I didn't think so. No one's going to raise their hand. I don't have an Alexa or smart speaker. Not sure. I'm not ready for that totally. All right? I didn't get the Apple Watch first thing because check out the security model. When I ask people at the store, they're like, you know, we haven't actually thought of those questions. I'm like, okay, I'll come back in a year when y'all thought about it. But we're still buying, and the consumers aren't demanding. Whether you're an individual buying for your home, or you're buying for your sports team, or you work for an industry and you're making decisions for the company about what to buy, we are not demanding that the vendors do their job in creating secure devices. And if they don't have it today, to push them to do proper design for these endpoint devices. And the last one here is IT organizations aren't necessarily properly equipped, properly budgeted, properly staffed, properly trained to manage these hundreds of endpoints. It's a challenge, I get that. At even a big company like Cisco, where we have a huge IT budget, we have a huge number of people, we have a huge security team, it's still a challenge. You can't keep scaling your people with the number of devices. You have to have management at the network level. You have to have visibility at the network level. You have to have onboarded identity at the network level. You just can't keep hiring X number of people to do this. So it's a challenge. All right. So my architectural complexity is a challenge. Now, if you have a Wemo device, just use Wemo. I don't know anyone actually buys those anymore, but that's what I did when I was doing this research, right? Very simple. You have the little light thing. You put your connected light bulb in. You have another thing you plug in the wall, and you can make them all talk, and you can go, you know, if then that on your app, and you can make the lights go off and on. You, woohoo, that's pretty cool. With Alexa, you can do more things, like Alexa, open the drapes. Alexa, turn on the stereo. Alexa, turn down the lights. Alexa, tell my kid to go to sleep. With that speaker in the Alexa room, you could do a lot. But they get increasingly and are complex just by nature. So today, our use case is connected medical, just because I deal with connected medical all the time. Would like to. I would actually buy this solution. I would use this solution on here. And you could just replace the names, pick something else. You could pick connected retail, connected transportation. So we have our home patient, right? Our home patient has a Bluetooth-enabled inhaler. They make those, right? Smart inhaler. The new Sethi stethoscope, I actually want to get one of those. Kind of cool. Anyone seen those? Actually records the sounds, and your app will tell you if it's crackles, reikis, or rails, which is all important thing to know. All I know when they tell my husband it's crackles, it's not good, right? Or, you know, an oximeter. Maybe many people don't live by those, but we do in my household, right? And so the patient at home has these things to better manage their health care. They can get alerts from the doctor. The doctor go, okay, your O2's been trending low. You need to go to the hospital. They're actually going to sign up for this service. There's a web server involved there. Maybe various cloud storage. It might be Azure. It might be Amazon. And here, they're doing cloud storage on Azure, probably because it's less expensive than Amazon. Right? We have an analytics server. We might have multiple that's doing the trending analysis on the patient data. Talking to the doctor, he's going to get an SMS, he can send a message to the patient. Now maybe the patient gets sick, the doctor advises to go to the hospital, now he's in the hospital. He's in a nice hospital, has connected medical, right, in his patient room. Well, one, he has an RFID bracelet, maybe has a GPS sensor in it, they can keep track, maybe think that's not important, but sometimes patients walk off the floor or they go down, right? They have a fall. They have a new app on MyHealth. It's like the bedside on your tablet, so you can log on for those of you who like to geek out on what's my latest, you know, what did the lab report look like? Because I want to know the lab report for the doctor comes in and talks to me because I'm going to ask questions about it, or the x-ray or whatever it may be. And some of these older machines, they weren't intended to be connected to the network, but it just makes things faster because you don't have the radiologist sitting in the hospital waiting for the wet read to come through, right? They're sending it off somewhere so you can get the wet read immediately and have a diagnosis. You have the hospital record system that may be connected to electronic medical records, and there's multiple. It's nice if you go everywhere and there's one, there's not. I was in El Paso. They didn't connect to what I have here at PAMF, so they didn't know my husband's history. It's like, once you go connected, you really don't want to go back. So what's the challenge with this? This isn't even very complex. Think about now Alexa in the OR, smart speakers in the OR, because they're doing that. The storyline is because it's going to help the doctors and the nurses with the checklist. Okay, did you remember to pull out all the sponges? Did you actually close the sutures? Blah, blah, blah. Did you do all this so they could detail? But Michelle's personal comment is, that's just a way to get in the door. Because in the cell is, wasn't that convenient? How about you need to check, okay, what actually was, did we get the right blood type? Or what was the history on this? You actually, if you're the patient on the table, you might be asleep, but you want the doctor to have that speed at scale for a diagnosis or pull up your thing. But how does that increase the complexity? What if somebody did adversarial AI and they said the wrong thing? That's what we gotta think about. So what happens in terms of the attack patterns that may come, right? So here, my stethoscope is new. Maybe it used an old version of Micro Linux, and so it has an issue on it. And so really when it was crackles, they said there was no crackles, and then there's pneumonia, and I couldn't tell the doctor he had pneumonia. Or the web server, right? We have threat actors trying to get at the web servers all the time, multiple attacks. There's tons of attacks on web servers. Even if you have good coders, you can still, it's hard to actually write 5 lines of secure code. I started as a coder. We didn't have secure coding when I was 18. They have it now, but there's problems out there. Or you may, in the hospital, like I said, you have older machines that weren't designed to be connected to the network, but because now they needed to actually connect them for faster, expedited service, now they're throwing these network cards or whatever. They're connecting older, whatever type of machine to the network. That might get compromised on there. Hospital record system, you know, and I've actually seen this, the nurses using the rolling station, reading email or surfing the web. I've actually seen them surfing all kinds of stuff. At the end of the hall, I'm like, guys, no, ladies, we don't do this. They get hacked, like the Target hack, right? So they get hacked, their identity gets hacked, they get into the server, they steal the hospital records, right? All over. So there's challenges out there. And many networks don't have, we're gonna talk about some of the things, they're not gonna have the micro-segmentation. They may not have the monitoring. There's a lot of organizations that don't have the resources to have 7x24 monitoring. Well, threat actors know that. They're not gonna like, okay, we're gonna do our attack Monday 8 to 5. Or, you know, that they're gonna attack in the odd hour. So the architectural complexity is only increasing. Now, if you think about connected transportation and our autonomous cars and all the roadway devices that are collecting the traffic, and then all the different entities between the departments of transportation, it's great. But that's a huge threat landscape when you think about that. But what's the impact if you don't have it? In terms of connected transportation, just one scenario of connected transportation I thought was real interesting. I was at a conference. It was a very small partner thing in Denver for the Department of Transportation, different states in there. And there was a gentleman, they talked about the coming across one mountain pass. If there's a crash on the mountain pass, everything to the east can't get through, it holds up the whole state, it holds up all the things. Now that they've done connected transportation, they can have those sensors, or they can sense roadway conditions like it's snowing or it's getting icy, and they can have people prepare in advance. They can reduce those type of incidences and have faster resolution. I mean, we all want that, right? I think that's cool. But has the national vehicle different boards solve some of the privacy issues with it? Have they solved the security issues? Do they actually have over-the-air updates for the firmware that's in your entertainment console system, which is actually the pathway to get to anything in the car? Most of them know. Or you think they're using the latest version of Micro Linux? Maybe not. And it has to be small. I mean, because, for example, a design challenge is that cars that have a backup camera, by law or regulation, that backup camera has to be on within, I think, 2 seconds or 20 seconds. I know it doesn't happen because I always count my car. It's supposed to be on a set number of time between when your car goes on. And I'm always like, mine's really slow. My computer's really slow in my newer car. So that doesn't allow you to have a very big kernel. And so you may not get some of the security features because you have to make sure you get the backup camera on in time to sense that. So think about the complexity of a connected city. What about if you deploy something and you go, oh, well, you know, we really don't want to do that anymore. And then you need to take some of it out. Are you going to take out all those sensors? Again, a couple years ago when I was doing the research for my master's thesis on operational security excellence in the Internet of Things, I read a report about the parking and traffic within San Francisco. I chose San Francisco because near where I live. And I talked about how San Francisco, they were, and it was a grant from the U.S. Department of Transportation that they gave sort of the winners. So at a very high level, San Francisco decided to go smart parking. So they did the meters, they did the parking garages, they did the apps. And so they wanted to determine the effectiveness of the solution. So what they did when they put out like 8,000 sensors and so many smart meters, they actually deployed people to double check on, did that meter, is someone actually parked there where the meter said it was parked? And in the whole traffic flow of the city, if anyone's driving around now, it was horrible. It probably took me 10 minutes to go around a building. Did it get better? And they actually determined, according to this report, that the 8,000 sensors, in-road sensors they deployed, was not making that much of an impact. Their smart meter stations and the actual smart parking on there with the apps was more effective than the in-road sensors or the on-street sensors when you park over it says, oh, there's a car here. So then they hired people that went out and, well, first they hired people to drill the holes and put in the 8,000 in-road sensors. And then they hired people to go out and drill out, take out the in-road 8,000 speakers. So that's something to think about as well. Because there's going to be some cities that may say, you know what, we're just going to leave them in the road. We're not going to do anything with them. Okay. Are they on? Can they do like a little off on button? No. DOS attack in the streets of the city. What's going to happen there? That could be a pivot attack. Hasn't happened yet, but it may happen. So you have architectural complexity on here. I know the lady, I know where she's sitting with the sign, but I'm just pretty bad watching. Here's another challenge in terms of operational security excellence is the fusion of IT and OT. If you're an IT person, you don't necessarily know a lot about OT. You don't know about the little, you know, the water meter, the HVAC system, all this other sort of stuff. And if you're an OT person, you certainly don't know much about, you know, if you're the robot person in the manufacturing floor, you know all about the robots. You don't necessarily know about how to manage the firewall. And the two groups don't talk. Well, in the world of operational security excellence, you need to make sure that those groups are somewhat integrated. They know about each other and they're working together. Because their focus, their priority, the types of attack, everything is different between IT and OT. In an ideal world, you'd have the perfect fusion. Maybe your IT guy knows all about how to manage the robots and do whatever, knows about the sensors or know who's to call and understands that, okay, well, our number one priority is to ensure the confidentiality. The OT persons know our number one priority is to ensure the availability. If you're on your company's incident response team and you have an attack, you're like, okay, we need a segment, we need to take down that device, we need to do X, Y, Z. And the OT people are like, hold on. It's all about availability. We just can't shut this system off. Something serious might happen. We just got to run with it. So how is your network going to be able to help us out the fact that we have to keep operating when there's this threat? And then downtime. Right, if I'm on my IT network, I need to upgrade something, I need to put a new router, I can schedule my downtime window, I can do it and it's all good. If I have, think about some of the big events we had, whether it was Ghost or Heartbleed, all that required upgrades, and if it was in the OT network, it's like, okay, our next down period is 9 months, 12 days at, you know, 3 a.m. and you have 15 minutes. How do you operate in that kind of mode? So you have to, the fusion of it is what's going to work out well, and understand these differences are going to help you have a more secure environment where you have the intersection of IT. Okay, promising practices. I don't think there's really any best practices yet today because there's so many different variations on a theme that's happening. So call them promising practices. So two paths. One way I like to think about this is the not so pleasant path, brownfield. You know, if you're walking around, you step in something brown, you're kind of like, that wasn't very pleasant. And you really want to clean it off your shoes as fast as possible, right? Not ideal. However, in this plush green lawn, minus the little brown piles that might be in there, you totally want to walk on the green lawn. That's how I like to think about it. So ideally, we could all operate in a greenfield world where we're starting up. We're going to build a new hospital. We're going to build a new manufacturing plant. We're going to do connected transportation. We're actually building new roads and highways. So we're going to think about it from a connected solutions perspective. We're actually going to plan for it. That's ideal, right? Because then we can actually design security in the network. We can take the right measures to do the right thing. But that doesn't happen very often. Right? What we have today mostly is brownfield implementations. Because we have our even something deployed, you know, 2 or 3 years ago, it's going to be legacy infrastructure. We're all moving, we're innovating, we're trying to do the great stuff, so we're just going for it. Right? It's all about how do we get ahead. The individual companies, like, how do we gain market share? We have to be innovative, we have to go for it, and we'll figure it out as we go along. Right? If you don't take risks in this economy, you're going to get left behind. If you don't transform, you're going to get left behind. Right? And so from a brownfield perspective, understand, and I'm always about, if you understand the risk and you can plan accordingly, then you can make the right decisions. I'm on here. Going back to our hospital example, right, from a brownfield environment, you're going to have the normal dry erase boards where they write all, maybe some of you haven't spent a lot of time in the hospital, I've waited in there way too much with my husband, dry erase boards where they write down your information, and I always make sure I erase it when we go. I like to sweep the room. Whereas in a greenfield information, you'd have a spark board. Now, how cool would it be going to a hospital that has a spark board in your room? The doctor comes in, pulls up your test, and he's actually going through it and explaining everything. It'd be totally cool on there. Right? In a brownfield environment, you may not have a way to do automated onboarding and device identity. You don't even know they've connected. You don't even know what's on your environment, but you have to deal with that. Maybe some of you have things like, you know, from a Cisco perspective, identity services engine out there, and you have other way to onboard. But from a greenfield environment, you would have something to automated onboarding. Again, maybe something like Cisco identity services engine with MUD, manufacturer usage description, that says, oh, this is a hallway camera, and here's the things that you do. Don't allow it to do anything else, and then ICE would implement a policy. That would be the greenfield environment, right? In a hospital environment, you're not going to have the minimal segmentation that you'd like, especially in an older hospital like I spent with my husband 2.5 days last week. I mean, the hospital was probably built in the 60s. It had a bathtub in the, anyone seen a bathtub in the patient's room? And the hot water faucet didn't work. I was like, whoa. It's just not going to have segmentation. Maybe they didn't. It actually had 2 access points in the room. And I was like, I'm sure only one of those work. I really wanted to climb up on a chair and kind of check it out. One was a Cisco one. I know the Cisco one was probably the newer ones working. The other one I didn't recognize. And I kept looking at them going like, okay, this is kind of interesting. Why do we have 2 access points about 20 feet apart on there? Unless it was something else I didn't know about, which happens too, right? In a brownfield environment, you're gonna have actually completely separated IT and OT. Or in a greenfield environment, you can look how you might do the fusion, you might merge the team, you might have comprehensive data monitoring. What are the things you need for operational security excellence? Decide on a framework. There are multiple. Get connected to an IoT standards group. There are multiple. I list some of the references. What we use at Cisco that we settled on, right, and the team I work with, we prior to becoming what we are now, we kind of expanded. We were the trusted IoT team. And so we're looking at how you actually assess risk and security posture for IoT solutions. And we settled on the NIST model plus privacy, right? That's why I call it the cyber resilience framework plus privacy. That's why I call it plus. That's not an actual thing. I made that up. And the slides are available on the thing. So here it's great because it's an easy framework. Like, does my device or my solution have a way to provide, identify? For example, does it do authorization prior to onboarding, right? Does it have no default passwords, seriously, right? This is an example. And then in the back of your slides, when you download them, you'll actually see more of this. Do I have a way to add protection, right? Can I secure the communications? Do I actually have measured boot, secure boot? Do I have tamper-proof enclosure? Because many of these IoT devices are out in the open, especially connected roadways, connected transportation, connected harbors, right? They're out where we can get access to them. Do I have a way to detect incidents, right? Do you actually have threat detection on there? Are you doing logging and auditing? These are some of the things. Do you have a way to respond? Do you have a minimal security operations? Do you have 24/7 monitoring? Do you have, 5/24? None. Do you have on call? How do I respond to that? What can I do? Do you have a way to recover in a whole incident when you get DDoS? Say you're one of those companies that had all those security cameras and you got DDoSed and you needed to do something. You needed to take them out, you need to update the firmware, pull them out, whatnot. How are you gonna recover from that perspective? Privacy, actually probably should have started with privacy. Are you thinking about privacy? What's the data being collected? Do you do the minimal stuff? And with whole GDPR of last year, we're coming up on 1 year. At a minimal, you should be doing a privacy impact assessment and understanding the type of data that's being captured on here. And again, there's in the reference section, you'll find a lot. So here's a way just to look at it through particular layers, right? Identity, access management, authorization, onboarding, updates, that all falls in there. And then whether you're at the endpoint, the network, or the application data, these are the particular security capabilities that you want, and these are detailed in the reference slides at the end of the presentation that you can download from your RSA app or whatever the site is. We talked about some of the endpoint ones. From a network perspective, because these endpoint devices aren't going to be able to provide the proper security for themselves, some will. I mean, these are consumerized, very cheap devices. If you want to, 25 cents a device, 10 cents a device, you're not going to get a lot of good stuff until you get up to $3 or $4 a device, and that doesn't scale on here. From the application data, right, can you provide encryption? Can you do any code signing? Are you scanning the software? Do you know that you have secure coding? And then monitoring visibility across the board. What are you doing? Are you logging? Are you logging to a central location? Do you have the capability to audit the logs? Are you using machine learning? Are you using AI? Where's the data being stored? How are the data sets being collected, merged? Who has access to the data? What are you doing with it? Down here you see download the full worksheet. I think that might have been the first slide. So I have limited printouts, which I'll be up here, but I was trying to get it the mail. When I got here, I asked, if you go on to the RSA website, the app or otherwise, probably tomorrow where you find the PowerPoint, you'll find the worksheets. There's 7 pages of worksheets. I have some handouts here, and it asks all the questions that you need to ask down there. Okay, so some of the things about business leaders, I'm watching the time here, so I can get some questions. So some of the things they can do, and I talked to, as part of doing a research for the master's thesis, I went and talked to some CEOs and some other folks and came up with some of the things they worried about. Some of the questions you wouldn't think about, like when we talk about privacy, does the IoT solution involve the collection, use, or process of any data attributes that identifies an individual from which the identity or contact information can be derived? Yes or no, right? One of the things down here, like, have you thought about what's the economical impact if there's a breach? Is it something that you would be, what is your material loss level from an executive standpoint? It might be $1 billion. some companies have that. Just, oh, it's a blip, right? I think that Hartford Health is something like a billion, it's not even a material loss, right? From an executive level, what percent of the funding has been committed? Some of these projects are 2, 3, 4, or 5 years. And if you don't get funding for the whole 5 years, which you usually don't up front, what happens when you're halfway through, there's no more money? And all your security features were in the later releases, you don't have the implementation. So there's questions there for executives. For IT leaders, there's some other questions in there as well, again, about the data. I like something just to get you think. What statement reflects the current state of your IoT endpoints? We fully support IoT endpoints in our infrastructure, and we establish and enforce network policies based on intended use of devices. That's all of us, right? Or we're certain we have IoT endpoints in our infrastructure, but we have no clue where they are or how to manage them. That's probably more of us, right? There was actually 5 responses, right? So that's something. What's another good one for an IT? Have you validated that all your vendor products meet critical requirements? Or I like this. What accurately describes the vendor viability or product maturity? For example, the vendor's a startup company, less than 3 years old, and the product's first generation. Might be a little bit of risk. This happened in the city of San Jose. Again, they were doing parking solution, putting in the in-ground parking things. The vendor went out of service before they finished the project. Oops. Yeah, so some things to think about. And then at the end, okay, whoops, did I go back? Okay, that was IT. There's another one in the same, it'll all be in the same PDF, is the implementation worksheet that you're working through. These are things, again, in terms of the year-long research project we did, a group of us that were going for our masters, the things to think about. And if you're in an IT organization or part of it, I'm just saying this was just suggested. These are things to think about. You can pull it off and like, okay, here's some questions we can think about. Right, endpoint device gateway consideration. What's the intended use? I mean, these things that might seem basic, but some people don't even think about it. Are you using it for lighting? Using it for room control? What are you using it for? Is your endpoint device free from backdoors? Any remote code execution without authentication? That happens quite a bit. Any default passwords? How does your device connect to the network? Is it through a gateway? Is it a multi-node network? Is it direct connection to the network? Okay. Some of these are about supply chain. Interesting. Not interesting. You need to really think about it. Where are these components coming from, and did they get mucked with from point of origin to point of sale and implementation? Did they get some extra parts added to it? You know, is it that replicating the issue that's around there? Again, is an OEM, is an original vendor? And what about third-party code? What are they doing in terms of third-party code? So if you download the worksheet, you'll have all the details on there, some of the questions. Again, at the references section here, you'll have some other things that you can do. So I do want to allow some time for questions, but the standard apply slide. So think about, what was your perspective in the beginning? Maybe you have two perspectives. Maybe you're like a totally connected home geek, and you have monitoring, you have Alexa, you have sprinkler system, you have everything. You just went out like, I'm going all out. I'm going to have all this cool sort of stuff. And or maybe you're in the business. You're in the process of doing, in maybe you're connected building. You have connected lighting. You have in-room presence. You have, you know, the kiosk stations on there. Is, you know, what you could do right away, maybe some of you are going to do it tonight. It's like, gee, really, what was that version of Linux that was running on that device that's actually controlling my garage door and front door and all that? For example, how many people bought Rings? They were so cool. Got to have Ring doorbell. And then we discovered that, you know, a lot of people were watching streaming video because it wasn't secure. That's kind of an oops. Right? That happened on the other cameras as well. So identify your attack surface, whether it's in your organization or at home, right? Within the 3 months, right, hopefully many of you that need it will download, or you'll come up here, I have some, download the worksheets. There's actually 3, 2 are questionnaires, one's an implementation worksheet, and really begin to think about, what are we doing within our organization? What do we actually have? Or what are we thinking about? What am I responsible for? They sent me to RSA because we're doing this IoT solution, and I'm the one that's like, I have to secure it, and I have to plan for it, so you're on the hook. Maybe you don't know anything, you know a lot, you just want to validate, download the worksheet, and begin sort of planning your strategy. Always we should be keeping abreast of the attacks. If you work in a connected solutions environment, you're doing consulting services, I can imagine this now becomes part of people's consulting services. I've had it happen to me before, it's okay. You know, you need to know what's happening. Like, I don't know what happened in the last week. I really wanted to kind of look up what IoT attacks happened in the last week, or perhaps, like past RSA, something's going to happen in the course of this week. History says it's going to happen. It hasn't happened yet, but I'm sure there'll be something big and interesting that we can all talk about. Go out and investigate some of the security alliances. There's multiple in the, and there's some in the back. You have a list of various ones that you can look at. I don't know, this is on here, there's a reference slide. I list some. There's probably more standards in the process that we would like, but at least we have choices. Whether you're an IEEE or you're a NIST or you're a NISA or whatever, different states and countries, there's just going to be something out there you can look at. Maybe you can make your own from one of those out there, but look at that. And then hopefully, you know, within 9 months, you're all IoT experts if you're not already, and you have practices to share back to the community. Like I said, I don't think there's any best practices yet. I think part of the heart of the solution is that vendor companies begin designing a better product from the ground up. And as consumers, we need to push them to do that. As consumers, we need to be informed and understanding what we're putting in our environments. Are we checking off some of these things? Because the attacks that have happened for the last 3 years, there's nothing new. It's all variations on the theme. It's the same things that we're seeing that it's like, can we please get it right? Because the number of devices are going to keep increasing beyond measure, right? We'll get to that 30 billion in there. So with that, we'll switch to questions, the last few minutes for questions. If not, I'll kind of put these. Well, if you have a question, please go to the mic. If anyone wants one of these, I'll put them down on the front. But if you have a question, up to the mic. And I will pick them up when I go, too. Yes, sir.
I'm asking a question. It might be answered in your backup slides. Your worksheets had many questions targeted toward the vendors of the connected devices. You know, do you have measured boot, secure boot, backdoor, software updates? If I'm a manufacturer of a connected device, is there a standard that I can target and give that to someone executing a checklist or a worksheet like you described? It seems like there should be some guidance.
Yeah,
for the
so the question,
makers.
In case you didn't hear it on the recording, is there something you can give to the vendors? Now, after the Mirai attack, and I have more of those run out, I believe it was, it wasn't the NIST, it was the DOD, or another one. And Cisco was one of the people that provided comments and input on that. They created a top 10. I think the reference might be in here. They, like, at a minimum, if you're considering devices, these are 10 things, the IoT critical 9, that you should have on there. Hopefully I put it on there because that's an important one. It was the, no, I actually don't have it on there, but there is one. That's 10, these alliances that are listed in the reference section have them. My questionnaire is actually geared for the IT professionals. These are things that you can go to the vendor and say, but you can pull off some of those standards. And the one that was from the US government, it came out in like the end of 2016, it was prompted by Mirai. I mean, if people did those 10 things, if manufacturers did those 10 things, we would be a whole lot better than we were on there. Yeah. Another over here, gentlemen.
Hi. Firstly, thank you very much for this. Very useful. So it's really just a question about whether you're seeing the regulatory and compliance world actually catching up with the technology. I kind of see IoT solutions, it's a bit like the Wild West at the minute. And actually, I really would want to see regulators. I mean, it's kind of linked to that other question. You know, connected device manufacturers have no real view on privacy or security in the way they're developing their technologies. Actually, I think we need to have the regulatory frameworks in place to make sure that they do that. And that's probably got to be done vertical industry by vertical industry, because the device manufacturers are very different in each one.
Yeah. And that's a great question and a great statement. So it's about, do we need some regulatory controls around her? Because it certainly is the Wild Wild West. When you think about that, a manufacturer can put out a device with a default password, admin blank, that allows you access to the video that might be in your house. It was like, you shouldn't be allowed to do that, right? So there's multiple in progress now, whether it be regulatory in European, what's the name of the word? There's some European standards, though actually I think they'll be ahead of the United States in actually getting regulatory controls. I want to see trust label. There's multiple. I should have that. I should know what those are because our group has been contributing to it at Cisco. But it's a slow road because at one point the government's like, you know, when we did the, after the Mirai, we did the 10 thing, they talked about we actually need regulations because this is like, this can be serious. Because when life can be harmed, like with robots, you know, or the next thing, the next smart speaker is going to be an actual robot. And what happens if it gets hacked and it goes do bad stuff? But excellent. Regulatory progress has not caught up. It may take 20 years. If you think about GDPR, that was based on something that came out in the late 90s that was little ankle biters, right? 20 years later, or more than 20 years later, GDPR passes and it's a megalodon bite. And people are going, oh, I guess now we need to do something. And I think it's going to have to be some big impact and it will take time, but definitely. I mean, even prior to Mirai, there was an executive order that came out. I'm just thinking about all the research I did when for my master's thesis. There was an executive order came out from the president and said, hey, we need to relook at this. The OECD Council met again. They actually updated their guidelines because they hadn't been updated in 20 years either because of these attacks. So it's coming, but it's definitely not at the pace that we need, given that in the last hour, we have another 50 million devices that are connected on the internet. So that's an excellent question. So one thing that we can all do is demand tighter controls and press our vendors like you need to do this. And what avenues do you have within your country, whether it's US, Europe, Asia, on the different regulatory processes are like, hey, this we need to push for this. We don't want total tight controls because that might be too hard. But even like the concept of the trust label was you buy the product just like an aspirin bottle. Warning, right? Or you buy the product and this is some of the IoT devices. Here's the root password. And so we need the warning label that tells us what we're getting into so people can make informed decisions. But excellent point. Okay. Thank you. Pardon me? Yeah, that was the one. Yeah, so charter trust. But there's another one, earlier one, that was like the trust label. So, yeah, there's, and they're trying different, I mean, because people realize this is an issue. So, but there is, we all know from past experience, the regulatory space kind of moves at a snail's pace. The innovative pace is more like grease lightning. The two rarely meet up until it's too late, but at least they're making progress on that. Other questions? 2 minutes? Yeah, 1 minute. There's the sign. I was looking for the sign. She's in the back. 1 minute. All right, yes. When I think about industrial control, that actually has one of the best standards. I don't know what it is right now off the top of my head. We've looked at that one. They actually have a great standard, like for connected manufacturing, and there's a really great standard. I should know that one, but there's so much of my candidate. Will they merge? I mean, they have to, because you're seeing more and more connectivity within the manufacturing floor. The space that hasn't caught up enough that I still is definitely outdated is the whole energy and those types of industrial controls. There's a lot of legacy systems, way old, and they're just basically building perimeters around it to make it more secure until they can do the upgrade, right? Who is the vendor that got the very big hit because it was just recently? Very big hit, fines, because they had some basic stuff that they shouldn't have. I can't think about it. Remember we saw the article that was posted? Yeah, I can't think of it, but actually big hit. Basic stuff, there was a report that came out, it was this year that came out about what they were, equivalent of, you know, PG&E is already in hot water, but you know, doing basic stuff like not implementing patches, huge fines because of that, and then the environment, whatever they're controlling it. But there is, and I should know that standard, that's a great question. The industrial controls, the security standard is pretty good for IoT, that one. Yes. In which you sound like you're familiar with that one. So what was that? 62433? Yeah, okay. So that's actually a good one for manufacturing. Way too much information. My brain doesn't hold it all, especially given what all's happened in the last 11 days. So, all right, well, thank you all very much. And if you want the handouts or something, I'll have them.